Welcome to you and a happy Christmas. My name's Helen and I'm from Grace Church Sandbach. We're really glad that you're joining us this year for the ladies' carols from Wheelock Heath Baptist Church and Grace Church Sandbach. It's easy, isn't it, to be distracted and maybe a little disheartened by the way things are different this year. But we believe that the true joy of Christmas can't be altered by COVID, and it can't be taken away from us. It's contained in this first carol we're going to sing, and which is O Come All Ye Faithful. And there's a line, God from God abhors not the virgin's womb. And that's talking about Jesus, who was God himself, but he came right down into this world as a human baby to be with us. So after we sing that first carol, Jenny is going to read to us from the book of Matthew in the Bible, from chapter 1, starting to read at verse 18.
Oh, reading is taken from Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to call his name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfil what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
You can see in that reading that Joseph and Mary found themselves in a situation where they just didn't understand some of the unexpected things that were happening to them. But God did help them to see that these things had been promised from long ago, and he started to show them some of the things that Jesus was going to do. This next song introduces to Mary some of the ideas and the truths for her about what her child is going to be like and what he's going to do. It's called Mary, Did You Know? And it is a song that some of you may know. So if you know it, please sing along. That's great. If you don't, just sit back and take in the words. And after we've sung that, Catherine is going to read to us from Luke in the Bible, from Luke chapter 2, and starting to read at verse 1, and she'll read verses 1 to 20. And after Catherine's read for us, a small group will sing a song called Silently We Watch. And that song is in essence a song of praise to the Lord Jesus for what he has done for us.
Baby boy, but one day will God cause a Reading from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 20. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favour rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Amen.
Silently we watch as our God steps down from his glorious throne into this poor world.
Taking to himself his tiny human form, he who made the
In just a few minutes, we'll hear from Felicity, who's doing our talk for us today. And just wanted to introduce Felicity to you. Unfortunately, we can't be in the same room for me to do that, but I'd like to introduce her. Felicity is married to Jonathan, and they have two boys called Rufus and Billy, and they are 4 and 3. And Felicity and the family live over in the States at the moment, in Illinois. And they're working, Jonathan particularly, is working with the company 10ofthose.com, and they are working to ensure that there are good resources, good Christian resources, spread far and wide across the United States from that company at the moment. Felicity tells me that before she was out there doing that, she used to be a secondary school teacher in the past, an English teacher, and she's also spent time teaching women the Bible before they moved out there. So when she's not looking after the boys and home life, Felicity tells me that she enjoys keeping up with her family back in the UK, which you can imagine is really important, playing tennis and reading some good books. So in just a moment, we'll hear from Felicity. Felicity's going to speak from the book of John in the Bible, and she's going to speak on a passage in chapter 1, starting to read at the first verse. So before she speaks, we're going to hear from Laura, who will read that passage for us, John chapter 1. And then verses 1 to 18.
The reading is taken from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light, he came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, This is the one I spoke about when I said, "He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me." Out of his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known.
Home for Christmas, sung by Michael Bublé. No doubt you've heard it across numerous radio stations all across the nations. It's a classic, isn't it? I'm sure Bublé was not the first to sing it. But what he didn't count on was the COVID spanner in the works this Christmas. He sings, "You can plan on me." But we know in 2020, you can't plan on anything. I don't know whether you're going to be able to make it back to your childhood home or not this Christmas. Maybe actually you're quite pleased that you get to stay in your own home. And maybe you're avoiding the more complicated relationships that come with extended family, or those set in stone traditions that you have to navigate and work out what's going to happen or has to happen when. We had our first Christmas on our own last year, actually, simply because we live in America. It was a mixed blessing for sure. We definitely had a longing for home as we thought of everyone eating chestnut stuffing and Christmas cake. But we did also have a delight in making our own traditions, those kind of barbecue your own bacon on Christmas morning kind of traditions. Making yourself at home is a bit of an art form, I've realised. We had a period of extended transition. About 18 months ago, we were kind of without a home for about 10 months. Thanks to the kindness of family and friends, we never actually were without a roof over our heads, but we definitely had that sense of longing for home. And in that time when we were without home, I realised as we were moving for the third time in 4 weeks into different living quarters, there's definitely an art of making yourself at home quickly. And I've realised that what you need to do is you need to unpack quickly, hide the suitcases, get the toys out, and fill the fridge with familiar food. It's a sort of swift making yourself at home. The only problem is actually if you do that in the wrong place, which actually did happen to us not that long ago. We were on holiday and we arrive at the house where we think that we're staying. And you know, you do the swift making yourself at home and unpack, and we're kicking back on the sofa and food's in the oven. And then the people who are actually staying in that house turn up at the front door. It's total confusion. Turns out we're in the wrong place. And there's just a really quick, embarrassed grabbing of all of our things and running out of the door. We definitely make sure of these things now. Home. Maybe we'll be there for Christmas, maybe not. But what about a home that lasts forever? What about a home that's better than anything we can imagine now? If you just have a quick look back at that passage we read, the word that John mentions is another name for Jesus. And John, the writer who was there for much of Jesus' life, tells us all about him in this account. Jesus is at home with God. He was there before the beginning of time. It's a place of light and life and permanence. And he's settled. He's not in a makeshift home. There's no threat of being moved on. Jesus is home. Darkness can't overcome it, and it can't overcome him because he is of the light. And this home, it's separate to our world. John makes it really clear that Jesus was coming into this world. So he starts in a different place to us. The Bible calls that place heaven, God's home, Jesus's home. So settled and belonging in heaven, Jesus chooses to step down into our world. Just have a look at verse 9. The true light, Jesus, is coming into our world. John uses a few kind of journeying words that help make it clear that Jesus is coming from another place, from his home, to be with us. He was coming into the world. He came, and ultimately in verse 14, he dwelt among us. He leaves his home to come and dwell with us, to live among us, seemingly to make his home with us. But it's not permanent. It's not his original forever home. That's with God, that place of creation, life and light. Jesus is there at the beginning. He's with God. He is God. He's at home in heaven. And yet, he chooses to leave his home and come to ours. And that's what Christmas kicks off. Jesus, who is God, puts on flesh and enters our mucky world. He journeys from his home to ours. That familiar story of a birth in Bethlehem, in a manger, the baby placed in that manger. That is Jesus coming into our world. This place that, if we're honest, is more full of darkness than light. This place that sometimes we love, but sometimes we think, what has gone wrong? I don't know whether you have a similar kind of lockdown discomfort to me, where I feel like my heart and my attitudes, the darkness of them, are more visible when I'm confined to one space. There's no distractions, no scope to look elsewhere. And you just have a glimpse at the news or the social media, and it just confirms how much we need this light, how much we lack light. There's no doubt that he came. Jesus is in the history books. He walked this earth, dwelt among us, came to our place. And he did it because he loves us. He left his home to come to ours. It wasn't because we invited him, not because we were waiting for him with open arms. In fact, it seems that our doors were slammed in his face. Have a look at verses 10 to 11. We see how we failed to receive him. The world didn't know him in verse 10. And in verse 11, his own people did not receive him. We preferred the darkness to the light. The thing about the light is that it exposes whatever's in the dark. We walk into a dark room and flick the switch so that we can see, and it's the same with Jesus. As he enters our world, he brings light and exposure, and suddenly the darkness is on show and we're ashamed. So there were no welcome parties, no delighted hosts, no relief that he'd finally come. He was rejected. The world chose the shadows, and with that, Jesus was not wanted. But, says verse 12, to all who did receive him, to all who did believe that he was who he said he was, who trusted that he came from God, who welcomed him as the light that we need in our darkness, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not out of any kind of particular family credentials or out of trying to live a good life or anything like that, simply born of God. And the qualifier is whether we receive Jesus. Jesus, who is of light and life and God. Jesus, who left his home to come to ours so that we could become children of God. I love that sentence in verse 12 because it describes the intimacy of the relationship with God, him as our Father, but also the legal permanence in that word right. We have the right, as we receive Jesus, to be in loving, permanent relationship with the Creator of the universe. We're swept up into the light, glorious, life-giving light. While we were in our homeless transitory time, we had some wonderful friends who invited us to come and stay with them, and it was just the most remarkable act of friendship. They made it very clear we could stay as long as we needed to. They cleared out a bedroom, they cleared out the food cupboard so that we had as much space as we needed. But it was more than that. They were our friends. We ate together, we talked together, we even did a part of Christmas together. We were family for that 2 months, and we were so grateful for their welcome. Now, Jesus does even more than what our friends did for us. We become his brothers and sisters. We're welcomed into the family for good, not just when we need, not just for a short time, but forever. Our status changes. While we're with our friends, as you might expect, we didn't change our surname. But Jesus, with him, everything changes. While we were of the darkness, as we step into and accept his invitation, we step into the light. We step into life. Life forever with him as God's children. As he steps into our world, bringing light and life, ultimately, Jesus invites us to join him in his home, his original forever home with God. If we receive Jesus now, our eternity is secured with him. Now, Jesus didn't send us a letter. He didn't bash out an email. He didn't wave and shout and holler from heaven. That wouldn't have been enough. We needed him to come to us, to leave his home and step into our dark, rejecting world. He needed to come, roll up his sleeves, and deal with all that stops us getting into heaven on our own. He needed to come and deal with our rebellion and our rejection. As we hunker down in the darkness, slamming our doors in Jesus' face, choosing to shut out the light of God, Jesus, even while our backs are turned to him, shows us outrageous love. Christmas sees Jesus arrive in this world, and we can't really think about Christmas without remembering Easter. While Jesus was born into a manger, he died on a cross. It's on the cross that Jesus deals with our insistence on living in the darkness, our continued rejection of God. It's through the cross that he takes on that darkness, our darkness, and gives us the light. He died so that we could have our forever home in heaven, that place of light and life and God, and where there's no darkness. I have two children, they're 3 and 4, and we love the Shirley Hughes stories of Alfie. I don't know whether you've come across him. He's a cheeky chap, a curious preschooler who gets into all sorts of mischief, as you can imagine, with that age. And our favourite is the story of Alfie when he manages to somehow lock himself in the house and his mum and his baby sister outside of the house. And by the end of the story, we have everyone in the whole street gathered on the front step, trying to work out how to get into the house, or at least how to get Alfie to open the door. Quietly, while they're all working it out, Alfie quietly pulls up a stool, stands on it, undoes the latch, opens the door, and you see this wonderful picture of him with his triumphant smile that he's managed to open the door for himself. It's a great story. We love it. As we're stuck in the darkness, we're on the outside. We're not Alfie. Heaven's doors are locked. Even if we enlisted the help of everyone we know and everyone we wished we knew, there's no way of opening those doors. However hard we try, however resolved we are to be good, however well behaved we think we are, we can't get anywhere near God. We can't get light without Jesus, the true light. We need Jesus. We need his light. We need his unconditional love, seen as he steps into our world, and ultimately seen in his death on that cross. However much we love our home or long to be back there, a heavenly home with Jesus is better. That sense of security, settledness and safety, that sense of having a familiar roof over our head, when you think of heaven, it is exponentially bigger and better than anything we can imagine now. Home with Jesus, eternal, light-filled, life-giving, without sadness or sin, heaven is ours with Jesus, a better place, a better home. Christmas sees God stepping down, a long way down, in the person of Jesus to be in the muck of our world and to hold out the invitation of eternal, light-filled life with God in heaven. An invitation that he guarantees with his own death on the cross. Without Jesus, we have no way there. We're stuck in the darkness. But with him, as we accept his invitation, the door to his eternal heavenly home is open. That place of light and life and and God. I read a story recently of an African schoolboy who was giving his teacher a present. It was a beautiful shell. And as she was opening it and thanking her, she said, "It's amazing, it's wonderful, where did you get it from?" And he named a lake that was quite a long distance away. She said, "Oh, you shouldn't have gone so far, that's far too far, just to get a present for me." And his simple reply was, "Long walk, part of the gift." Jesus had a long walk from his heavenly home to our mucky world. And he came out of love for us. Born in that manger, but ultimately come to die on the cross and rise again so that we, who don't deserve it, might have life and light and eternity with him in his glorious permanent home. The invitation is open to all, and it's as simple as receiving Jesus himself. Receiving Jesus is as simple as recognizing that we're in the dark and need the light. As we turn away from that darkness, seeking to live in the light rather than dark, we receive Jesus. It's like walking into a room and recognizing that we need to turn the light on. We know we need him. And as we do, we're swept up into God's family, into the light, and into that permanent, glorious, heavenly. If anything that you've heard just now sparks your interest, if you are thinking that you'd like to find out more, please do get in touch with whoever it is who told you about this, who got you watching this. A great start would be to actually read John's Gospel for yourself. It is an eyewitness account of Jesus's life. I'm sure that someone from the church would be really willing to read along with you and help understand what's going on. If you did actually think that you wanted to receive Jesus, to receive that light, again, please do get in touch with someone from the church.
Thank you, Felicity. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for taking the time to do that. After what Felicity just said, I'm going to pray briefly. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the Lord Jesus. Thank you that he was willing to leave his heavenly home and to come into this world to deal with the problem of our rejection of him. And I pray, Lord God, that this Christmas you would turn our hearts towards you. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. So, just like Felicity says, if anything that she said makes you wonder or makes you ask any questions, please do speak to anyone that you know from either of the churches, and they'd be more than happy to either speak to you themselves or let you know about a short course that we often do called Christianity Explored, which is a really informal and easy way to just ask all your questions and find out more about the Christian faith. And so please do speak to anyone about that. But also, even though things are different this year, both of our churches have lots of things to offer. So both of our churches are recording carol services this year. One will be available on the 18th of December and one on the 20th. And after that as well, they'll be available. So there's plenty more carols and talks and things to listen to there. So please do go to our Facebook pages or our website to find out more information about those. Also, both churches are running Christmas trails for families and children this Christmas. It's an outdoor COVID safe activity we can do that is fun and free and enjoyable for all the family. So again, look on the Facebook pages and the websites for both the churches for more details, and also you should find some more information in the description box below this video, particularly relating to the trails. So do look at those and find out more if you're really interested. Thank you so much for watching this video today, and we do wish you all a very happy Christmas.
Jesus.